I mean, I grew up thinking that one day I was going to visit it, and now I have to say, I've been up and down there at this incredible place on Earth. Not just because it is as spectacular as, you know, mountains, and those mountains are coming out of the water, but this place called Galapagos has been capturing the attention of so many people for so many years, because of the biodiversity that exists there. This particular place have particular species, which makes a lot of sense. It's all connected, as we know. It is land, it is water, it is the air, it is those currents that come in from Antarctica to kind of cool the waters of these islands in the middle of the Pacific. Those things have been happening for millions of years, and today more than ever, we need and we have to save them. So we want to talk about that, and we want to talk about all of those things and the knowledge about, you know, those areas, the information that we've been getting out of these areas for years, since Darwin and others, you know, that have been visiting and creating incredible stories and have been able to actually show us why is it that important. So we're going to be talking here with incredible people that also happen to be good friends and also people that I have the honor to know, because they really are incredible scientists, activists, and everything. So they're kind of the new generation of octonauts we were talking about just right before. I want to start presenting Dr. Sylvia Earle, which also is my biggest hero. Dr. Sylvia, as you know, she is the chairman and president of the Mission Blue, the organization that I actually also enjoy to work in. And she's also a National Geographic Society Explorer in Resident. She is her deepness, and nobody else better to be called that way. She's been down in the ocean so many times, and she's been, of course, one of the most important scientists. And, you know, someone who's been teaching us so good, so well, so much about the ocean. Another incredible person that I know for years, and I have the pleasure also to share, you know, many now stories with this, Alex Hearn, is a professor and researcher from Universidad San Francisco de Quito. Alex, it's an incredible scientist, but also it's one of the scientists like Sylvia that breaks the kind of, like, you know, the structures, and then goes to also do his best to protect or to try to move things in the right direction to protect what he's also studying. So it's not just getting information out of there, but also getting something else. And so he has been studying one of the most prestigious universities, Southampton in UK, and also Harriet Watt University. So also kind of my lens there when I study in Scotland. So we have also that connection. Alex, welcome here. Then I have to present a very good, who has becoming also a good friend of mine, and I've been learning so much about the ocean from Manuel Yepez. He is he's a captain and owner, but also he is a scientist too. He's been working with Alex for several years and doing incredibly well for helping science in Galapagos. And he's amazing. He has incredible stories. He knows the ocean so well too. And he have learned many things through it and have actually changed his life through learning more about the ocean too. He used to fish actually for some species that now are protected, and he's now working to protect them. So very good to having you, Manolo, to welcome here. Then is Daniela Fernandez, who many of you knows. I think it's a little bit also, I could say, the one of the new or next Sylvia Earle. She's an amazing scientist. She's an amazing activist. Her passion kind of, it moves everyone's, and I think she's been able to mobilize so many people through her Sustainable Ocean Alliance, or SOA, organization. She started early, young, like very young, and she's also a proud student from Georgetown University. It's almost, I can see it from here, from Washington, D.C. So incredible, successful, young activist, scientist, I mean, it's innovator, etc. I think you're phenomenal, and what you're doing, Daniela, is amazing. So welcome to come here. And finally, to present Cesar Peñaherrera. I also got to meet Cesar through an incredible organization, a collective, I would say, of people and organizations that are working on this region that I have been actually able, and he have been one of the engines of this new knowledge or things that I have been discovering and kind of like put it together. Cesar Peñaherrera is Ecuadorian marine biologist. He's been studying in the sharks and many other species that are actually moving in this region, which is extremely important to understand because animals move and they come out of the of countries. They don't know about administrative sort of definitions of countries or regions and marine protected areas too. So he's been studying in Australia, in Tasmania, as well, and he, as I said, is a key engine for the MigraMar, which is probably one of the most important research institutions or group collectives that exist. So welcome everyone for coming. We are extremely happy and also honored and proud to having you all on this launch of the Hope Spot. The hope, you know, that we have so much hope. And how do we move from hope to also kind of leaving a legacy for all the people and the fish that are under there? Sylvia came out with this incredible idea of the Hope Spot. This sounds so obvious now. But Sylvia, tell us, how did you get to that point of, you know, thinking, why is it needed? What triggers that need?
Well, the idea, Max, is not original. I think as long as humans have been around with a relationship to nature, it's pretty clear that we can't take it all and still have a world that works in our favor. When our numbers were small, we could take wildlife as a source of sustenance without huge impact. Now, with nearly 8 billion people, the planet has not grown, our numbers have grown, and the natural world has been diminished because of our appetite for everything, you know, trees, water, fish from the sea. We've just taken at a level that now we know we have to step back and realize we put our life support system at risk. What we do to take care of the natural world that takes care of us, or what we fail to do, will determine the future of humankind. We can go too far in terms of cutting the trees, taking fish from the sea, contaminating the air and the water. And we have gone too far. We have to right now take account and see what we can do to recover from the damage already done, now that we know how important it is, that we could not know when I was a child. We used to think that the ocean was too big to fail. You could put anything into the ocean, it would just go away. And the ocean was so big and so resilient, we could take anything from it, no problem. And we really have taken so much so fast and put so much into the ocean so fast. That here we are in a lifetime, my lifetime, I'm a witness to this swift change. But there's also a change of attitude now that we know. And the idea of embracing nature with care, I say it's not a new idea. The national park system that began more than 100 years ago in the United States, and it's really an ethic of caring that goes back perhaps to the beginning of humans and their relationship to nature, that It's caring for the systems that take care of you. And the way that Hope Spots differs a bit from some of the other really important initiatives is recognizing that you have to start somewhere. You have to start with people who are in the area who have a direct vested interest in the outcomes of protection or use. And you could say, we all have a vested interest in what happens anywhere in the world. It's true. But to really make it personal in parts of the world where people can take action and have an impact and see the impact, and then share that information, that whatever it is that's happening, with the rest of the world. That's the idea behind the Hope Spots. We now have a network of more than 130 places around the world with champions, with communities dedicated to trying to take what now exists, whether it's an area that's in pretty good shape, the Galapagos is an example, or one place like San Francisco Bay that is not in such great shape. But in both cases, we can go from where we are to get to a better place.
And so thank you so much, Sylvia. I mean, this is, your words always resonate since I first read you, and then I met you, and I've been hearing, and I have the pleasure to keep hearing you. I mean, today we live in a very particular time. No, there is a pandemic, and I think it's so critical now to think about what do we need to do. And I want to ask maybe Brett if we can show some of the pictures pre-pandemic, just a few, you know, like weeks before the pandemic. We were in Galapagos. It was a different world. And, you know, the community of Galapagos has been through a really hard time. Manolo can tell us more about that, because there's some few places that, you know, on Earth that are so tied to tourism. I mean, this is a place that everyone wants to visit. That makes a lot of sense. But once we stop that, what happens? You know, I mean, what happened with you know, with the people, with business, with everything that are rooted on this biodiversity and this beauty and this incredible place. One of the things that struck me the most, it's those sharks too, those animals that we saw down there. They've been there for millions of years. Is it the same for us? Are we going to survive all of these things? Are we going to change in order to kind of change our behavior? And Alex, I want to start maybe with you to, you know, first of all, to describe for us a little bit of Galapagos with all of this, you know, thoughts that I'm throwing right here on, you know, what is the Galapagos? What is the situation now? Remember also the pandemic, what is going on there, etc. And so maybe Alex, tell us more about the current situation. What is happening there? What we saw in November, what is happening now? You were the other day, I mean, not just long ago, you went to Galapagos. I hate you a little bit because I really wanted to go too. but no, happy for you. And tell us.
Yeah, it's funny. I'm looking at the panelists here, and the last time the four of us, I guess, we're together, at least Sylvia, yourself, Manolo, and me, in the same physical space. It was up at Darwin just about a year ago. And we were up there, some stunning diving. I remember the conditions were quite challenging on a couple of those days, but it's always, always a pleasure to be up there. And I didn't really think we were going to get to go up there again for a while, because it's been so hard to get to Galapagos throughout the coronavirus situation. But thanks to my friend and colleague, Jonathan Green, who leads up the whale shark research with me, you know, he really, really pushed to make this research trip happen. And we were up there just about a month ago, again with Manolo, because we have a kind of several projects going on up there at the moment, looking at tuna movements and how climate change may affect those. And obviously with our big project with the whale sharks, trying to understand why is it that these huge whale sharks appear at Darwin every year. To be honest with you, it was as spectacular as ever. It never ceases to surprise me being up there. We were wondering, I mean, we'd heard all sorts of things, both positive and negative, about what might have been happening up at Darwin and Wolf. And really no one knew, because no one had been up there. I think we're the first trip up there since the lockdown. And I remember on the last day we were there, we went to pick up an ultrasonic receiver that had been in the water for a year. And I was down there with someone who'd never been up there before. And we went down to pick up this receiver. It was going to be a short dive. And literally, it's 5 minutes down. You find the receiver and back up again. And we ended up running our air down to the bare minimum because we couldn't leave the site. And Jeff and Maho were with me. And it was just a steady flowing river, not a stream, a river of hammerheads coming past. And I know, you know, because we've tracked them, we know that they go around in circles, but still, it was at least hundreds, if not thousands. It was one of the most spectacular dives we've had. And that was a Wolf, which is sometimes thought not to be as good as Darwin. So it was a spectacular experience. And it's comforting to know that, you know, we still get those numbers there. We still get that diversity there, that there's still hope, you know? So really spectacular. I'm hoping to go again pretty soon.
That's great. And talking about hope, I mean, when we went together there, I met someone who's been giving me a lot of hope on how we can actually also change the world. And Manuel, you are, you know, a father who have, you know, different experiences in your life. You are now also suffering with your community, the pandemic, but you're a resilient person and it seems to be connected with the ocean. Tell us more about you.
Well, it's a pleasure to be nominated first champion for Mission Blue as well in Hope Exploring Galapagos. It's a pleasure, not only for me, it's a really pleasure of Galapagos. And I got to do my best. Sometimes I start be a fisherman. It's changed too much until now. Now I'm involved in tourism, but a few years ago I'm involved in conservation. This made me more understand about what is the real situation about ocean, about marine life. Because before I had this experience of being a fisherman, and my generation was a fisherman people. I remember many years ago when I was 10 years old, I just went out with my dad in a couple hours, I can catch a lot of fish. But the situation now is totally different. But we know we have a lot of problems in our bug and our marine reserve is it's a legal fishing, boat fishing close to the Galapagos. But what are we gonna do now? It's start to change the view of the people, the new generation. And for me to be involved in conservation, let me more understand what I can do now. It's one of my big challenges now to help, to protect, to help to pass the voice to the new generations of Galapagos. Pandemic in Galapagos give us a big understanding now. Now in Galapagos, the situation is so difficult. Like March, every May, this town was like a ghost town. You came into the Galapagos, nothing happened. Everybody's just inside. Boats stopped, fishing stopped. And one way it was bad, and this other way, I can see it's really good. I think it's good to give a breath to the natural, to the animals. I went back doing something fishing, but I can see the animals feel like really calm. You can see more animals around in its own habitats. What are you gonna do now? You know?
Exactly, yeah.
It's keep moving, yeah.
And I like your words. I mean, I think that's exactly the thing. We, you know, we are facing constantly these changes in the world. We're facing climate change, one of the biggest threat to humanity we've seen, and now the pandemic, we need to kind of like, you know, be better adapting to this thing. We've been becoming a little bit too kind of, you know, slow to react to those changes. We've been a little bit too comfortable maybe. Cesar, you work with Alex on this too. You had the ability and the beauty of actually being in the water a lot of time to recording, studying these animals. Can you tell us more a little bit of this? And by the way, Cesar, if you ever have another, same with Daniela too and everyone, you guys are some of the best presenters. I am not even closer to you guys. And if you, any of you are there looking now, you have the opportunity to kind of follow these people in other presentations when I speak less. I think I would totally recommend this. It would be great. Cesar, tell us.
Thanks for the introduction. And thank you everyone that is around at this time hearing us. It's a real pleasure for me to be here and be part of this webinar, and also to virtually meet Sylvia, which is a person that I've been following for my whole career, actually. So thank you again. Am I allowed to show some slides right now, or is this
part of the... Go ahead, please. Yeah? That would be awesome.
I would like to tell you a little bit more of the story that we are talking right now. I love the concept about hope spot, and I would like to everyone know why we consider this is something that it's one of the best ideas ever right now, to show the truth and importance of Galapagos. You know? So I would like to call not only a hotspot for the people in Galapagos or Ecuador, but a hotspot for the world. And the reason why is that this bit here is one of the coolest maps that we have so far. And this is part of the MigraMar work, trying to technically assess how everything is connected, not only the Galapagos. But I was hoping actually to take, maybe I'm going a little bit too further ahead because I was expecting Alex to show something as well. Am I, or am I not? Because otherwise I won't do any spoilers so far, but I just wanted to show you that what we are doing right now, it's very, it's called unique, and the opportunity that I have, thanks to Alex, actually, because he was the one who took me on board of this whole idea of the Shark project and MigraMar. Thanks to that, we've been able to show how Galapagos is not only a place that is completely isolated from the world, but is part of a unique system that I would really like to actually promote the idea that Galapagos is not a standalone area. It's actually fully unconnected, functionally and structurally. And I'll go further ahead, as I said, no spoilers so far, but this is something that I would like to say about how Galapagos is so important. I don't know, just... But,
no, that's great, Cesar. And you make it such a good point, because we keep thinking, you know, a little bit worry me sometimes that we think that we, you know, protected areas also, we're encapsulating everything. Like if we can actually maintain like a kind of a dome over those places, and it's not true. I mean, we need to do much more. We need to do much more in marine protected areas. That is for sure. But also trying to save the ocean as a whole. These places are too small to maintain the health. And Sylvia constantly says that about the health of the ocean and how it is totally connected to yourself. And I want to go to Daniela. Daniela, you know, Galapagos is one of these places where, you know, Ecuador is so proud of it. All the people, I feel it's so proud of Galapagos. And also people are very proud of having a Daniela there too. I think, I saw messages even from the president, you know, welcoming you also the other way. You got also awarded, and, you know, how that relates also with your work? Do you think you have some sort of imprinting there with the Galapagos connected with yourself and the organization, which has been doing so well?
Thanks, Max. I absolutely do. Well, I was born in Quito, and I remember growing up, my grandma always used to take me to the beautiful coastal areas of Ecuador. And so I grew up surrounded by nature, and my love for our environment and for our ocean truly does come from my Ecuadorian blood. And I just had the chance to visit the Galapagos last year. So it was incredible to really put it all together, you know, going from being born in Ecuador to moving to the US, starting Sustainable Ocean Alliance, and then coming back to my home country and seeing the beauty of nature and, you know, how incredible it is that we have so much biodiversity, so many species, that I almost felt for the first time in my life that I was a stranger in someone else's land. And when I say that, like, think about it. As humans, we're the ones who take ownership. We're the ones that are territorial everywhere we go. But in the Galapagos, it's not our land, it's the animals' land. And it's one of the only places where you feel like a true visitor. So, you know, in having this conversation, and I'm sure we'll get into more details later on, it's so important that in every action we take, we act with urgency, and we have to take bold decision making, right? Because we don't have a lot of time to waste. Our animals, our biodiversity and wildlife depends on us to make a difference in what their future looks like.
Completely. Well said. And it reminds me of the thing that Sylvia, you always tell the story of your first visit there. Can you tell us, do you remember that day when you stepped down or when you went down in the water of Galapagos?
My first visit was in 1964. It was on a research expedition, and it included scientists from many countries, but it was the first time that diving had taken place in some parts of the Galapagos where we were privileged to go using scuba. Scuba has only been around, you know, during my lifetime. It didn't exist before that time. Now we take it for granted that we can slip into the ocean and be face to face with the hammerheads for more than just a few seconds, holding your breath, or a few minutes sometimes, but there are only 1,000 people, more or less, in the Galapagos in 1964. And the idea of protection for the land was just coming into focus, the establishment of the Darwin Station and the National Park. All this has really been helpful in safeguarding the land in the Galapagos. We're just getting to the point where we realize that we have to be proactive about protecting the ocean as well, and that the value of fish alive may transcend the value of fish that we take and put on our plates. I mean, when there are 1,000 people you could take to feed your family and the communities that were there, when you have 25,000 plus 100,000 or 200,000 visitors every year, plus fleets that come in around the edges and take from the fish populations on a scale that really are diminishing, not just the wildlife in the ocean, but now we know the wildlife on the land. I mean, it seems obvious. What do they eat? They need the ocean too, and more than for food. They need a healthy ocean, just as all of us need a healthy ocean. It's our life support system wherever on the planet we are. But in the Galapagos, we can see like a microcosm of what's happening all over the world. Where we embrace nature with care, everybody prospers, including the people. When we take to the level where we see the loss of, just in a lifetime, the collapse of animals that once were abundant, and I have been a witness to that in the ocean. The ones that now, with a larger number of people and export beyond just the families living in the Galapagos, the numbers of grouper, even the small fish that are taken for bait, those are the very fish that the cormorants and the sea lions and the boobies rely on for their food. And they haven't had competition until we came along. And we've only been in the Galapagos. I know for someone who's grown up there, it seems like it's a long time because it's your whole life. But looking at from the standpoint of the hammerhead sharks or the boobies or the other creatures that are there, we're newcomers. We've only been in the Galapagos for a couple of hundred years, mostly since the middle of the 20th century. And we have to make peace. and find a way so that we can mutually profit. I think we can, because we've got this big brain on our shoulders.
Yeah, so that is true. Sometimes we don't use a mesh, you know, besides putting the helmets. But the thing is, you know, and I think it's important, Sylvia, to remember also, again, you know, Galapagos is not separate from other places. And I have several questions here about, you know, the impacts of climate change. Gray is asking. It's also the pollution, plastics. Daniela, you know a lot about that too. When we were in November there last year, we actually took some samples from the water 15 meters down, and we found plastic in the northernmost isolated areas. I mean,
deep water.
It's getting everywhere. And then we have the pressure over fishing, which you've seen the Chinese fleet that it was fishing outside of the EZ. Well, that also have an effect over Galapagos, because it's like, you know, trying to kind of grab the things that are inside of your garden, no? And like just peeping out there sort of thing. And then we have the fisheries of Ecuador itself, who have actually a huge effect. Industrial, which is a tuna fleet that is currently the biggest tuna fleet on Earth. And the other fishing, like the semi-industrial of longliners and all this. So, you know, how do we make sure that these things are actually going to be there for the next generation and for the generations of, you know, of, like, I don't know, my grand-grandchild or whoever, no? And what do you think there, Alex, what would be the answer for them?
Well, I think, Max, one of the problems is that a lot of us don't see those changes. We haven't been around long enough. And so you have this shifting baseline, don't you? And in fact, a great study that actually Cesar did as part of his PhD was to go to different dive guides in Galapagos who'd been working for 10, 20, 30, and 40 years and ask them, you know, what's a good day's diving for you? What was a good day's diving back, you know, back in the day? Was Gordon Rocks once like Darwin? And I think the general pattern, correct me if I'm wrong, Cesar, was that there has been a tendency for the open water species, despite the fact that it's still amazing, it's not quite as amazing as it used to be. And that really brings, you know, to one of the questions that I always ask back from those days when I started off in Galapagos. I was very much focused on, you know, Galapagos inwards, and it was all about the endemic species. And I was working on fisheries like sea cucumber and lobster. We started wondering, well, what about Galapagos outwards? What's the role of Galapagos to protect these species that move further afield? And what we're finding more and more with the research that we've done, and maybe I'll show some slides in a minute, but is that for a lot of these species, the marine reserve just isn't quite big enough. In fact, that hammerhead shark that we tagged last year with you, she ended up leaving the marine reserve, and she was real nuisance because she was just outside, like, just come on in, and she wouldn't. She kept outside the marine reserve, and then she spent about 3 weeks pinging back and forth between a couple of seamounts that we know some semi-industrial longliners use. So I'm not saying that she was caught by them. What I am saying is that there's a clear risk. And that we're seeing that more and more with hammerhead sharks, with silky sharks, with green turtles, with waved albatrosses. You know, it's across so many different taxonomic groups that we really need to start looking at how can we adjust the size and shape of Galapagos to capture migratory routes, foraging grounds. And to be honest with you, it doesn't mean a lose situation for these big industrial fleets or these big longlining fleets. They just have to fish elsewhere. I mean, they've got plenty of space to fish. They can reduce their catch. They can change their
I disagree with you, Alex. They just need to stop. This is a luxury market that this is not about food security. I disagree that they can go elsewhere. They just need to stop. We need to face up to it. And
Well, it is true that when Galapagos has been under threat, it's been when there's been a global demand for a resource that's local. And we've seen time and time again, you cannot feed, you know, the Asian market for sea cucumbers from a tiny set of islands. You cannot feed the North American lobster demand from a set of small islands. You cannot feed global demands from local resources. And until we get that right, yeah, you're absolutely right. We can't continue to exploit on those levels.
I think we're in total agreement about where what needs to be done. I do. Not criticizing you at all. I don't mean to sound that way.
No, but you're right. The Marine Reserve is not the right shape or size to fulfill the role that it needs to fulfill. And we're working on changing that.
And you know, Alex, I mean, we've seen some papers coming lately that, you know, the sharks actually that lives in this area, there wasn't studies about the DNA, I mean, the genetic test on fins in Hong Kong, which is the main market of the fins. And they have found more than 70% of the hammerhead sharks are coming from this region. More than 60% of the silky sharks are coming from this region. More than 80% of the thresher sharks are coming from this region. I mean, there is a problem. There is a problem of size of the marine protected areas, of connectivity and many other things. But I just wanted to point out, you know, and I love to hear you, Alex, and that's why you are a champion. And you and Daniela, you too are, in a way, you too also are a champion. Cesar too, and Manuel, you are an incredible champion from Galapagos. And Manolo, listen to this. There are people from Hawaii, Quebec, Canada, and other places, Charleston, the US, Kentucky, Westfield, Indiana, Portland, Oakland, Monterey, like you, the UK, Geneva, Buenos Aires, Kauai, El Salvador, Romania, of course, many from Ecuador, welcome here, Germany, Vienna, Austria, Peru, Turkey, Netherlands, Colombia, India, Puerto Rico, Italy, this is amazing, Brazil, Australia, Puerto Montt, que lindo, from Chile. There's people from all over the world looking at this. There are a few places that actually create this kind of interest. Yes, Sylvia.
Given what you've just observed, the world cares about the Galapagos Islands. And part of the focus of this conversation is to address the problem that the people who live in the Galapagos now, who have been relying first on fishing and tourism with the pandemic, have to rethink how do we have a livelihood while we take care of the source of our prosperity, the source of our lives. And, you know, we're all engaged right now, literally touching the world with new means of communication. I just want to throw it out there that the world cares so much about the Galapagos. Are there ways that we can find to get people to support the people of the Galapagos to take care of the natural world? I mean, it's already happening with the park and with the Darwin Station, but to really make it even more powerful and effective to be able to engage people so that the value of the ocean alive is worth more than the value of the ocean as products that are consumed and sold. There must be a way to take the new means of communicating, and the people who actually are living in the Galapagos, they live in the midst of, you have this extraordinary asset right there. If you can share that with the world without killing the animals, but to even vicariously, it's best if you can go and to be in the water, to get to engage these creatures. But with the new means of communicating now, there must be some magic that we can pull together so that you can share your view, the stories of the creatures who live there, that can be an asset.
Right.
I mean, maybe to monetize the living world rather than looking at the way you make money from nature is to take it out of nature, to, you know, kill the fish.
That makes a lot of sense. It brings me to, you know, Manolo. Manolo, tell us, you're the local, and, you know, I would like to hear from you, how, for your life and your family and your people there have been affected or not, or impacted in a good way with the marine protected area as you have now. Tell us more, what is your relation with that marine protected area?
Well, first it's like a bit difficult right now. But what can you say, how we can start to help to protect our marine reserve in Galapagos, like Galapagueños, like people we live here. Mm-hmm. I think we need to start first to understand where do we come from. If we don't understand where we come from, we don't gonna start doing anything.
Yeah.
Because the people, if they don't know the value of the place where they live, they don't can get it to be involved in help to protect. This is one of the first steps we need to do. And another thing, for my personal opinion, it's the political thing. When it's involved political inside, this is a big problem because it's too many benefits inside of Galapagos. That's the truth. As tourism is one side, fisheries is another side, science is a different side. But when we found it, the good way to work the three of us together and with the community, I think is we got to start to protect them more. I'm involved in fishing, tourism, conservation. This gives me more open view about the situation. I feel so happy because my generation is moving in different way. Mm-hmm. Now I'm involved in conservation. I understand. I can go to say another fisherman who I'm involved in to say, this is how it's going to happen in the future if we don't take care now.
Yeah.
I know the past is go, but now is the future. Yeah. All my experience is I share with all the local fishermen. Some of them, they understand me. Some of them, they don't. But I'm just pushing them all the time. I show them all this is a beautiful life. How beautiful is to have a sharks in life that they shark. You know, give you more money to have them in life. When you are tourists, working tourists, you come in with a lot of tourists and show them, look, this is the beautiful Kiki Rock spot that you can do snorkel with more than 100 hammerhead sharks in one moment. Go to another spot, you can see the baby hammerhead. Well, how valuable is that? People, right. They don't understand. Local people, they don't understand this value.
Yeah.
But when we start with local people, the real local, the kids, teach them step by step, they go to love. And this is how we can start. This is my view. This is my challenge. And this is what I'm doing now, moving from one side to the other side. I know the pandemic affected a lot, but even give you more understanding about the environment, how we can be more sustainable. It's possible. It's not like fishermen, they're going to stop, but they can do something else in a good way. Be more sustainable with the animals, with the fish, with everything. We cannot do it, but we need to be more effort with, start with the community. This is my view for the
Max,
future.
Can I chime in?
Yeah, go ahead. I was just going to ask you. Perfect. Go ahead.
Thank you. I appreciate it. And I want us to talk about solutions, right? Because oftentimes when we have these discussions, we get so depressed and we're talking about the problems. And I know people everywhere want to know what they can do, what's going on out there and how they can get involved. So let me start by talking about solutions from the local, regional and global spectrum, because we need all three for this to change. So from the local side of things, you know, when looking at Galapagos, when looking at Ecuador, we need to have people educated around marine protected areas, right? Getting them excited, getting them involved, getting them to put pressure on local governments, on their assemblymen and congressmen to understand why the value of the ocean, like Manuel was saying, is so important to them. And that only comes by educating, by organizing on the grassroots level. And that's something that I'm so proud that SOA Ecuador, under the leadership of Janice Marquez de la Plata, she's been leading these efforts in Ecuador. And so we need more people to rally with young people, with locals, with fishermen to understand and put this pressure on. So I definitely recommend folks to look into the expansion of the marine protected area in Ecuador. So that's the local solution. The regional solution, we desperately need to have Latin American countries organize to do regional monitoring and enforcement, right? Because as we all know and we discussed, these animals go from Ecuador to Peru to Costa Rica to Chile. They have no boundaries. To them, the ocean is their home. And so the only way for us to truly start adding pressure is to give governments the tools, the resources, the funding they need to provide monitoring enforcement to these fleets that will continue coming back. I mean, it's mind-boggling to me that these international fleets have returned to these areas year after year after year, and no one is putting a stop to them. And to our generation, if it happens once, let's end it for all. So I just think that it goes back to having the sense of urgency and determination to put an end to these, you know, horrible practices. And it's up to governments to take a stand at the UN level and also, working together. So that's on the regional side. And then on the global side, we still need to understand the importance of ending harmful fishing subsidies, because governments are right now giving money to these vessels to go out and fish away from the regional lands. So if we can cut off the capital stream, we will not enable them to have the gas power, to have the funding, to travel all the way across the ocean to a land like Ecuador, like Peru, and fish from there. And that again comes from a global, from a treaty standpoint, which most people don't know about. And the fact that people are ignorant about this topic, it's also problematic. So just to recap, one is expansion of marine protected areas. Two is ending harmful fish subsidies. And three is pressuring governments to invest more in monitoring and enforcement of their local marine protected areas and regions.
Completely. I think you touched, Sylvia, you want to say something?
Daniel, we could add to that get people to think about what they're consuming, that it's the marketplace that drives the taking of wildlife. If people said, I'm just not going to eat tuna, period, it has an impact on the demand. So it's and another aspect, in addition to the pressure on subsidies, it's the idea that it's okay, it's legal to go out. Those Chinese fleets were legally there. It was not illegal. It may be unregulated, but it's not right, but it's legal for them to go fishing. We need to rethink the whole idea of taking wildlife on such a scale that there's no way you can justify this as a sustainable exercise. And it does have an impact, not just on the diversity of life, the health of ecosystems, it affects the chemistry, it affects climate. There's a connection between blue carbon and the carbon cycle, which drives climate. And if you look at the big picture, it comes right down to individual behavior and on a personal, local, country, and then a global level, but everything ties together. Yeah. And I think you're spot on with your recommendations. And I think we can amplify it just a bit to be even more comprehensive.
And I like the positive note of Daniela too, because you mentioned of things that are in our hands. I mean, we can change politics because we go, we vote, we decide, we take decisions. In Chile, we just vote 80% to change our constitution. And trust me, we're gonna work on creating a constitution that actually reflect the protection of nature too. And we have also discussion on the WTO for the subsidies too. So there is actually an open door where Ecuador, everyone should make sure on all of these countries that I listed before, that you should be making sure that your country is doing something actually for changing the subsidies, because there are people who exactly are paid to go and catch everywhere around the world. And then basically, driving all this overfishing. Cesar, you wanna come back here, because I wanna also you to keep us showing us those opportunities too. What is it? Not many people have the opportunity as we have had to go under the water and to see this beautiful place. And I wanna invite you to show more of that too, because it's extremely important. This is just not a casualty. You don't see this anywhere. I mean, it is, there are few places on earth where you can see this beauty and this magnificent marine life under the water. So Cesar, if you wanna come, I wanna ask you more about, you know, what are the opportunities? What is this opportunity of increasing the marine protected area? There are some questions there, for example, how that is going to affect the fisheries. Can you tell us more about that, for example, Cesar?
Sure, I'm here, I've never left. Just, I really like to learn from all these bright minds that are right now in front of me, and also reading the questions and the interaction in the chat. It's very nourishing, I'll say. There are so many things that we're talking right now that I actually don't know where to pick. But I must say that my point of view of everything is that as a human, I think that there's a root issue here. There's an issue rooted in our formation as a human being that I would like also to point it out that away, which is very important, but away from the things that we are doing right now as a grown-up people in terms of marine planning and you know, marine conservation, there's also some stuff that have to be done at the level of the schools. What are we teaching to our kids so they actually understand what's coming next for them if they don't actually, you know, preserve our environment, not only the ocean, but also the land ecosystem. So I always like to, really like to talk to my students and the people that I go around that there's some values that we don't learn. And one of these is, for example, social responsibility, about how we interact with our others in our environment and society. But there's also environmental responsibility. This is one of the key aspects that we are losing right now in our schools, how we teach our kids, our children, to understand what is nature and how they actually, how it you know, benefits us, because there's no such a thing that the nature is standing still alone completely. No, it is benefiting us for. So along with this, there's also one bit that has to be like financial responsibility. And this is a critical point, for example, for low income areas, fishermen, that they don't know actually how to plan their life for the future. And this is one of the reasons in so many times that they are struggling because they want to earn the most money at that time. And that is one of the reasons, from my point of view, that it's putting coastal and ocean ecosystem in so much a pressure, because they are running right now to get the most of the catch. They are running right now to get most of the revenue at this current time. So they are not financially planning themselves to the future. And this is directly affecting ocean sustainability for the future, because they don't know how to plan that. And most of the fishermen, for example, in Ecuador, there are 40,000 fishing families that are actually, you know, relying on the oceans this current time. And there's a trend that they are leaving the coastal areas farther and farther because they are depleting the ocean areas. And now they are getting close to Galapagos. And why they're getting close to Galapagos? Because we have an amazing suite of species right there. If you allow me to, I would like to show you something that very quickly about what we have in.
Go ahead.
MigraMar, and all the scientists that are working right now. And it's this beautiful map that we actually produce. It comes from so many data, so many scientists. And every single dot that you see over there is one position that we track for any specific species at any specific time during the last 15 years. There are 15 species in this map, but you can see that there's like, I used to call it, I really like to call it like a clown vomit. There's so many colors on it. But you see from here that the species that we're talking about, sharks, sea turtles, marine mammals, marine birds, they're moving all around this region and they're coming and they're going from Galapagos as one of the key pivotal points actually in this tropical Pacific Ocean. So makes sense that we are watching right now such a strong accumulation of fishermen going around the Galapagos because these species are living there. It's one of the coolest hotspots in the region. And you see Galapagos is way connected with all the marine protected areas in the region. This is a heat map. It shows whenever it's color warmer, it's because there are more tracks, there are more species, there are more points that actually has been tracked on that area. And you see that that goes straight to Cocos, that goes straight to coastal Ecuador. They're moving these species around, but they're moving between these MPAs. So no wonder why Galapagos and other MPAs are so important for fisheries, because these species are moving way beyond this area. And this map is also showing why Galapagos at the current size is actually not potentially the best site to protect species that are right now under conservation concern, such as hammerheads that are critically endangered, or leatherback turtles that are also critically endangered in the Eastern Pacific Ocean. Just to give you a little bit more of data and information about why Galapagos, it's a hot spot for migratory movement, for migratory species, and it's a hope spot because if we preserve this region in the way that we should, maybe perhaps increasing the size and also adopting other management recommendations, regulations around its water, we will preserve what we are getting. There's coastal Ecuador, there's coastal Colombia, coastal Costa Rica, and coastal Panama. There's so many people living there that are actually depending, relying on the oceans. And Galapagos and all the other marine protected areas in the region are working heavily to sustain these fisheries, but it's not working. As Alex said, it's not working, unfortunately. And or just to end, I would love to see the ocean 50, 40 years ago, by the time, for example, that Sylvia had the chance to watch Galapagos. Alex has an awesome background picture of a hammerhead that right now currently represents 50% of what it used to be 30, 40 years ago. Just saying. So maybe I have thrown so much information to the discussion, but it's really critical, this bit of how Galapagos is working and how it should be better protected to better work for us for the future.
Yeah. No, but it's, I mean, like, you did a good job on, you know, how important Galapagos is, not just for Galapagos itself, but for the whole region. And the role of that Galapagos, no, is not just something that occurs to you know, we learned that this morning. It's been a study for many years, a lot of investment on understanding this area. And that's why also people go fishing there, because it's rich in life. And sadly, for some others, it's just, it is basically revenues. But for most of the people, even many fishermen like Manolo and others, you know, it is life. It is life. There are many questions that I've been trying to kind of put them on the kind of like conversations, but I want to go through some of them. There are several that question the climate change. So Alex, I'm going to go with you. The last question. Also on the pandemic, how it's been affecting and how that related with tourism too. Manolo, I'm going to ask you that. I'm going to ask you very short answers there. I think I'm going to go with maybe the marine protected areas opportunity there, Cesar, to give us like very concrete, specific, like why is it that we need to expand. I think many people also are asking how to get involved, and that is always a great question. Daniela, I like that you did a little bit of that. What else can be done? What else, you know, are the opportunities that can be done there? There's also even a Coast Guard from the United States that was asking on the what happened with the effects of the of the fishing fleet that the Chinese or others that are kind of fishing there. Are there, in effect, maybe you, Cesar, also with the other question can put together that. So, Alex.
Okay. Although I actually want to also, if you don't mind, answer a little bit about this idea of, you know, what the future holds for Galapagos, because I think Galapagos is unique in our general psyche, in that, you know, our perception of where we stand, not only on this planet, but in the universe, really comes from a lot of the work that Charles Darwin did while he was in Galapagos. And so I think Galapagos does present some opportunities for diversification of employment that perhaps some other oceanic islands don't. And so one of the things that just happened recently, the Galapagos Science Center won a fairly large award to start developing a genetic barcoding for the islands. And that's going to allow for alternative employment for different people. There's also Galapagos in the face of climate change, you know, with one of the areas that's first hit by El Nino events. How can we understand or use that understanding of the El Nino and La Nina cycles to forecast and adapt to living with this climate change, which is a reality, no matter how much some of our elected leaders wish to deny it. And so I think Galapagos could really take advantage of that unique nature and use that to develop employment. Let's not forget, I mean, a lot of us don't remember that we've got 500, 600, 16, 17-year-olds every year leaving school. They can't all become fishermen and naturalist guys. We really need to start thinking outside of the box. And just on another note related to that, I used to live in the Orkney Islands, north of Scotland. One of the most amazing sights on the planet, and I miss it every day, even though it's been 20 years. And one of the problems we had in Orkney was of a loss of population. A lot of the islands were becoming uninhabited because there was no job opportunities for people there. And there was a lot of work and effort going in. How can we keep those populations going? And I think nowadays, with the advent of internet and teleworking, Galapagos could benefit from conversations with places such as Orkney and how they've adapted to these issues. So that's on one side. And in terms of climate change, I think Galapagos is a little funny in that it hasn't seemed to show these general trends that other areas have, and that might be because it's masked by these El Nino, La Nina cycles. That's not to say it's not happening. We have had very serious impacts on our coastal waters in the last big El Nino events of 82, 83, 97, 98, when we lost pretty much, you know, 90% of our corals. And so it is something that we're still struggling to understand and get to grips with. But I'd actually also like to say, in terms of the species that I study, if we can't get the overfishing issue under control, then climate change is going to be irrelevant because there's not going to be anything left to protect. You know, we're losing. When the Galapagos Marine Reserve was created in 1998, scalloped hammerhead sharks were classified as near threatened on the IUCN Red List. 10 years later, they were upgraded or downgraded, depends on how you look at it, to endangered. And last year, they're now critically endangered. So, you know, if we continue these trends, you know, with species such as the waved albatross, the scalloped hammerhead shark, the oceanic white tip, the Pacific leatherback, climate change isn't going to matter because there's not going to be anything left. And that's really the urgency. We need to stop killing these animals, whether by accident or design. And that's where we need to really focus our efforts now.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Let me just show you, this is what we're trying to protect. I said I'd share some slides earlier on, and I never got a chance to. So let's just remember this, you know, that's it. That's hope, you know. Sunset by Darwin Arch, the gateway to one of the most amazing underwater sceneries you'll ever see. That's what we're trying to protect. And really, it takes us all. And I think one of the things I've learned in Galapagos is that we are working with so many institutions, with guides turned scientists, with dive guides who continue to bring information from for us, with fishermen like Manolo, who's out there every day gathering data and helping us. So I think really that's the way forward. You know, basically rolling up our sleeves, getting wet, and pushing this forward. I've got a few more slides, but I'll leave that for now.
No, thank you so much. That is, it reminds me so much of the beauty there. Manolo, your time for your question.
Okay. Can you see me again?
So we were talking, about the some of the questions that have been done, the tourism and the activities that are there, how they're part of the problem or part of the solution, and how do you see the solutions in the future for with this opportunity of the expansion of the marine protected area too.
Well, I think it's opportunities we have a lot with this extension of the marine reserve of 200 miles. It's going to be really big benefit, not just only for tourism. It's going to be benefit for all who live in Galapagos. Specifically, one of the sector is always fighting is the fishermen, because they think open 200 miles, they don't give it a chance, but they're wrong. They give you more chance to be more productive for them, because now fishermen just go fishing, they have a hard time for a week, they don't catch too much, because we know that boat fishing outside of the marine reserve, but when we stand, this is going to be really good benefit, but we need to teach them how it's going to be benefit for them. In another way, we need to let it know them that they can be sustainable fishing. That's really good. They don't need to fish in massive of fish. They need to be catch quality of fish. And tourism for them is good benefit as well, because we gotta have more marine life around the islands. Whatever place you go, you have more marine life because more protected. It's good for local communities as well, because they one another way they could be benefit as well. Everybody's got to be benefit. Everybody's good. But how I say, we need to start with local people to understand that why important is Galapagos. And this is the first step. And then we go with the political, and then we go to pressure the government with all of us, like a fisherman, like a science, like everyone, we can do all together, fight with the government to push them. When we push them, come on, this could be work.
Correct. Good answer. Thank you so much, Manolo. Daniela, how do you want to go with people for action? What do you think the chances are?
Definitely. So, I think that I've been reading everyone's chats, and in reality, you don't have to be a scientist. You don't have to be a PhD graduate. You don't have to have any titles or degrees to get involved and do something. So that's the first thing I want to say. And that's exactly why I started SOA. Because I was a young person, I was 19 in college, and I wanted to save our planet and I wanted to save our ocean, but I didn't know what I could do. I didn't really know the pathway or the guidance that I could take on. So that's the one lesson I would say is get involved, act locally. And I think that's something that's so important that, growing up, I think that, especially my generation has been taught that the only change that will happen is if you get angry, or if you write a petition, or if you go protest, but that's not real. You have to take change in your own hands. And it's a paradigm shift that every single one of us has to have, because we can no longer be spectators to what's happening in our planet. You have to be a solutionist in your own right. Go start a project in your backyard. Talk to the people in your local government. Talk to the people in your neighborhood, and build something from scratch and become a leader in yourself. So I think that's a message that I always give to anyone wanting to be involved in the local level and grassroots level. And of course, obviously Sustainable Ocean Alliance is an open home to anyone that wants to be involved. We actually provide education, resources, and funding to anyone who has a project in mind that wants to start it in their own region or local area. So definitely check out our activities to get involved. And again, I just want you to think about you becoming an owner of the situation instead of simply being angry and pointing the finger at other people, because it really is up to all of us to be the solution to solving this problem and helping our ocean. So thank you, Max.
Thank you. And Cesar, you wanna also answer the question of how, you know, this marine protected areas that are, you know, the one that exists already, and this possibility of increasing, how that relates also with the pressures. What would be your message to those who have doubts about it?
First, turn on the mic. Yeah, now. It's a very interesting question. We are facing right now this struggle between industry and conservation. And sometimes I feel that it's because there's this understood divorce between what it means to preserve our nature and potentially the industrial side. The industry right now is not actually seeing what we are seeing right, what we assess or research on migratory species, is that whatever is going to happen to the ocean is going to fire back to the industry, whether they like it or not, whether they accept it right now and deny it, or whether they accepted it, but they are not willing to work on it. So my concern is that if we don't act that quickly enough to make them understand that what they are right now, they're stopping, it's gonna affect directly to them, to the revenues in the future. We may be facing what Alex was saying, that doesn't matter if climate change arrives at some point in our human history, there won't be sharks already in the oceans. They will be gone, extinct potentially. Some of them are already going extinct. So the industry, it's a tough topic because the money always drive most of the decisions. But if we take into account what's happening right now in the Galapagos through the pandemic, we can have a glimpse of what's gonna happen in the future if we don't have resources within Galapagos. Like, the whole economy is gonna crash. It's crashing right now, and it's worrying because it's based mostly in tourism. And it is not an economy that moves $1 million, several hundred million dollars per year. And it's, fully comparable to what the industry is actually obtaining from outside of the marine reserve. So there are signs already that even tunas are trending down and they are near threatened, like hammerheads were like 20 years ago, as Alec was saying. So those signs are showing us that definitely actions need to be taken and the management has to be improved in and around our oceans. Let's not talk even about Galapagos at this point, but our oceans need a special planning design that will allow us to preserve the biodiversity and ecosystem services that we have. So I'm gonna take the words of Sylvia in one of the many documentaries that she has done, but I was watching, I'm super keen in the Netflix documentary that she was part on, and she was saying that we need a network of MPAs. Sure, we need a network of MPAs, and that's the only thing that's gonna help us. And MPAs that are in accordance to the specific conservation needs that we need right now. And the conservation needs that we have at the current time is to preserve migratory species in the region, because otherwise they will go extinct, and the fisheries that they are feeding, they will go extinct, and the economies that are relying on it, they will go extinct, and then we may have more than 50,000 families struggling to obtain jobs in the future. So what are we gonna do with that? What is Ecuador governments are gonna do with the 50,000 families that rely on the fisheries currently? And the Galapagos is like, you know, with the it's crashing right now to sustain, because it is not the size, it is not enough actually to do so. So and this is not only a question to the Ecuadorian government, it's a question to the whole governments in the whole world, because we are facing this threat at the current time, not only in the Galapagos, we are facing that threat in the region, the whole Eastern Tropical Pacific region, and in the world. And this is something that I think I'm aligned right now here with Sylvia, that her tenacity, her driving need right now to help the world, to help the oceans, to preserve the oceans, it's something that we need to support, like, with all our might, because it, otherwise, 20 years time, 30 years time, we won't be seeing what we was seeing 50, 60, or everyone was seeing, you know, like 40, 20 years ago. So this is kind of a struggle.
Exactly. Yeah, I feel the same sometimes. I mean, my kids are going to see even the half of what I have seen, you know, it scares me. But we have hope, and that's why we got the hope spot, and that's what we want to kind of celebrate today to people like Alex and Manolo, because they're the new champions for this beautiful, incredible, unique, iconic place that is Galapagos. And you know, for people to understand, we're not asking for anything crazy here. So we need to protect what it gives us life in this planet. The ocean is the source of life. If we don't take care of it, we can't take care of ourselves, of humanity itself. We depend on it. We can't live without it. You know, there is no good jobs, there is no good business on a dead planet. And that is extremely important to remember. We need air, we need water, we need food, we need everything, but mostly we need life. I want to start finishing here, and I want some very short statements. Imagine that you're talking right now to President Moreno, Lenin Moreno of Ecuador. He have a great opportunity. I mean, what a good place to be, seriously. Like being a president and being actually able to expand a marine protected area, leave a legacy that people will remember for sure, that he was the one actually who expanded. I want you to say very shortly, you are talking with the president now. And I want to make this because we are in a very political week. I tell you, I don't have nails anymore. I'm like I feel like, and so, we've been looking at what is going on. We all care about our planet and what is going on politics here and there and everywhere. I want you to talk to the politicians. I want you to talk to the leaders, and also guys that you are listening here. Write also a message for the president. What you want to say to the president now? Cesar, can you tell us what do you want to say to President Moreno, please?
To our president, as you said, he has the opportunity to create, this is a pivotal point in time, and he has the opportunity to secure jobs for many people. This is my take. I really like to talk about jobs and economy when I'm talking about conservation, because this is the best way to make people understand how important it is what we are doing right now. So with all due respect to his work, and I know that he may be leaving office soon because we have election next year, but he has the chance to leave a legacy that is gonna last for generations, and it's not gonna benefit specifically people. It's not only gonna benefit people from Galapagos, it's gonna benefit people from around the world, because Galapagos is a hotspot for fisheries, at least the water surrounding Galapagos. It's a hotspot for migratory species, which means that there's many ecotourism activities that are happening within the Galapagos. And also the reason why we are here is just to celebrate that it's the hope spot. So if we protected it right now, or better protected it right now, we are surely ensuring a long sustainability of our oceans in Ecuador and in the whole region. So please do it.
Perfect. Thank you. Daniela, what are you want to say to the president?
Yes, my message, even though I already tweeted at him after he congratulated me about the marine protected area, I want to remind him that expanding the marine protected area is key, again, to leaving the legacy behind, and also to think about young people, to think about future generations, and to be an example of a world leader who can potentially, you know, thrive in this space and show other Latin American countries the importance of expanding these marine protected zones. So I think there's a great opportunity here to show tremendous leadership, not only for in the country of Ecuador, but also globally.
Thank you so much. Manuel, what do you want to say to you? You're the new champion. As a new champion of Galapagos, tell us, what do you want to say? What message? And say it in Spanish if you want. Feel free, please.
Well, what I can say, Lenny Moreno, give us a chance. Give us a chance to show that everything is possible to the world, and not just only for to Ecuador. It's not only Galapagos. Give us a chance to say, is it possible to preserve in a good way? Is it possible to live in harmony with the natural? Give us the really good political to help us, everybody here. It's not just only a fisherman, it's not just only a science, it's not just only tourism. It's all the people living in Galapagos is going to be the benefit of protecting, as all the world is protected. This is one of the things I can say to the president, give us the best choice. Leads us a legacy for the new generation to protect Galapagos and live in with good way with the nature.
Thank you, Manolo. Thank you for your words. Alex, you have a message for the president?
Yes, I do. Mr. President, 25 years ago, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Yeah, 25 years ago, the people of Galapagos took to the streets to demand protection for their islands and their marine resources. They have shown that they are capable of doing that again when their islands and their way of life is under threat. And they have shown the vast majority that they are willing and able to take care of their resources given the chance. And as we move into the next generation and educate not just the next generation of Galapagueños, but the current and future generations of Ecuador, we can change this, which is a normal day's morning's work on the coast of mainland Ecuador. We can change it back to this, but it's going to take all of us working together. And that is your legacy, Mr. President, to bring us all together and to make that happen. Because if we can get it right here, there is hope for the rest of this blue planet too.
Thank you so much, Alex. Love your words. Thank you so much. And Sylvia, I want to close with you and your always wisdom. I want you to speak to the people and to the President Moreno too. You know, what is needed here?
Maybe. To the president, to the people of Ecuador, the people of the Galapagos, we are at a crossroads. What we do now, or what we fail to do now, will have a magnified impact on everything that follows. I'm not making this up. Anyone can look around and see the truth in this. So much change so quickly in the lifetime of 10-year-olds, let alone the lifetime of somebody who's been around for decades. If you look at the waters of Ecuador, and particularly the waters around the Galapagos, and think of it as, in a sense, as a library. We can burn the books and gain short-term warmth, or we can maintain the integrity and learn what's in those books for the long pull. There is so much to be learned, so much to be gained from that living library. Of course, we know how to do what they did, we've done throughout all of history, but now we know. Now we know what could not be known when I was a child, or when you, Mr. President, were a child. It is so 20th century to think that the best way to use the ocean is by taking out of the ocean. But this is the 21st century. And now we have knowledge and we have insight, and there's a sense of urgency about protecting what remains of the gifts that we have taken for granted. So take seriously not just the responsibility, but the opportunity to be bold, to be a leader, and to the people of Ecuador, the people of the Galapagos, look in the mirror, to use your intelligence, your ingenuity. The world is counting on you, not just to ask us, but I mean, I want to ask you for the ideas that you have, because you're there. You can see every day in ways that the rest of the world cannot, because we only catch glimpses. You are saturated. It's your home. I would love to hear your thoughts about how you can use the ocean without killing the ocean, how to really dive in the ways that are now possible, and think of concepts that can be shared with the rest of the world. This amazing diversity of life, this laboratory that has insights that will help the rest of the world come to grips with finding the balance between how many of us there now are and the shrinking natural world. We need to address this now as never before. We have a chance, you have a chance to be leaders, you in the Galapagos, you in Ecuador, and certainly you, Mr. President, to seize this moment and help find the way from where we are to get to a better place. We won't have another chance as good as the chance we have right now.
Thank you so much, Sylvia. Always is so great to hear you, and thank you, everyone. I invite every one of you that are looking at this incredible group of people that are, you know, working and helping to bring this to you. And I think it's such an important, incredible thing to do, to call attention for these places that they are actually, we are losing them. And this is a great opportunity. I choose to not leave my kids only buildings and roads. I want to leave something that is actually much important and unique than that. And I learned that from other people too. Thank you so much, Sylvia, for having created the Hope Spot, because it gives us an opportunity to call this attention. Thank you for you know, helping us to find also these champions as Alex and Manolo, which are incredible examples and people who are doing incredible things. Thank you, Daniela. You are really inspiration for so many, and I know you will go long way. I'm hoping to see you someday, like, you know, president or even higher than that. I'm sure you will. Cesar, you are an inspiration scientist who leave everything behind just to kind of working every day on what you do. And I really appreciate your knowledge and the way that you actually are able to share that knowledge, making it easier to everyone to understand. Thank you to Mission Blue. Thank you to SOAs and all the friends that have been there from all around the world. Thank you so much for being today with us, and keep following us. We will do more of this. And today we want to welcome and congratulate these two champions for the Hope Spot of Galapagos. Thank you so much, everyone. Take care.